Hi, I'm Derek Blasberg. I'm the head of fashion and beauty here on YouTube, and it's my job to welcome you to the first ever inaugural, never before attempted YouTube Beauty Festival. So why are we having a beauty fest? Three reasons. The first, to entertain. As you know, the beauty community on YouTube is one of the most charismatic, engaged, and fabulous communities in the World Wide Web.
I love this.
Second, to inform. We've compiled experts and industry leaders from around the world to lead conversations on beauty topics that matter.
This year has been tough on all of us.
And third, to celebrate. The beauty community offers us so much to celebrate, and today we're putting it all on display.
Yes. Yes!
I am so excited for the cast of characters we've lined up for today. We've got beauty gurus, creators, celebrities, actors, models, you name it. If they like beauty, they're here in this festival today. And now I get to say what I've waited so long to say. Sit back, relax, and enjoy YouTube's first ever hashtag BeautyFest.
This is the first video I ever uploaded. It was just me, a low-res camera, and my favorite beauty products. I was in college, I was very bored, I was lost, and when I was making these videos, I felt inspired. I felt like I had purpose again. I just wanted to create. I didn't expect so many people to watch. It was just a way for me to experiment, but I was so inspired by the comments that were left by my viewers. They wanted to know how to do their skincare, how to do their hair, my favorite techniques for applying mascara, and in a way, they were co-creating with me, and they gave me the inspiration to continue. I became a better makeup artist. I worked with my favorite brands. I even created my own brand and built a $1 billion business. I may have been one of the original pioneers of the YouTube beauty space, but I could not be more amazed by what happened around me. My name is Michelle Phan. I'm a YouTuber, makeup artist, and entrepreneur. Today, the beauty community on YouTube has evolved into an ecosystem that has garnered billions of views, and hundreds of thousands of videos, and tens of thousands of channels. Beauty content is everywhere. It went from being out of the mainstream to affecting the mainstream to being the mainstream. So, join me as we take a nostalgic look through the history of beauty on YouTube.
Hi everyone, today we're going to be doing a Rihanna makeup look.
When we think of 2007, we may remember this phone, this presidential candidate, this book, and this collaboration. I would say the early beginnings of YouTube was like the Wild Wild West. People were trying to figure out what to create. There was a lot of cat videos, but I just knew that this was going to be my new home. What would become the beauty creator industry started out as just a bunch of teenagers with a love for makeup, sitting on their bedroom floors and filming tutorials on their laptop webcams.
And I used all MAC except for Urban Decay Primer Potion because I just like that stuff a lot.
Since I uploaded my first video in 2007, there have been nearly 350 billion collective views for the beauty content on YouTube.
It's a silver play button for passing 100,000 subscribers.
We have reached 1 million subscribers.
Here we are at 1 million. I cannot believe
my channel hit 1 million. Subscribers.
Around 2014 is when the beauty gurus started going wild with formats and challenges. This is really when the beauty community went from being just about tips and tricks to being a form of entertainment.
Do you know how to use books?
Huh?
Beauty on YouTube became so influential around this time that even professional makeup artists started hopping on the bandwagon, opening the door to more secret tips and tricks.
I have Patrick Starr here today.
Quickly, brands took notice. A lot of creators were able to make a great career off of YouTube through amazing collabs and makeup lines.
Collabing with Maybelline!
Hi everyone! I'm on top of New York. And guess why? Because I'm about to launch my own makeup line.
Eventually, beauty gurus started coming out with their own makeup brands. Many of them immediately sold out of their products at launch. By 2017, YouTube beauty was a bona fide cultural phenomenon. Creators were all over the press and blogs. They were featured on huge TV shows or Hollywood films. They collaborated with celebrities. They signed book deals, including myself. They created their own clothing lines. They cross-collaborated with each other. They had so much fun. YouTube beauty became so huge that A-list celebrities even started hopping on the bandwagon and created their own channels, like Kylie Jenner and Naomi Campbell.
Are you guys doing each other's makeup?
No, we're supposed to do our own. I think we did too much.
Talented and influential YouTube beauty creators are leading the charge in so many new beauty areas. In just the last few years, we've seen a huge rise on YouTube of skincare and clean beauty.
Hello, that is not good for your skin.
These creators have helped show us that skin health really matters. As a result, they help propel brands like CeraVe and The Ordinary to extreme success. The community has become bigger than just makeup, collabs, and the views. Creators have started using their own channels to speak out about something that they truly care about.
I want to let you guys know that I love you and it's okay to be yourself.
As for me, I was riding the wave of the rise of beauty, achieving everything beyond my wildest dreams. But I'll be the first to acknowledge that being on camera every day and having such a public-facing career, it began to take a toll on me. In 2015, I suffered a burnout, and I desperately needed a break from the constant cycle of video uploads, from the negativity that I was facing every single day. I listened to my body, and it took a few years to recenter myself again. But when I came back on YouTube, I finally felt like myself. I felt like who I was when I first started. And I think that was the important lesson that I had to go through, was the journey of pushing my own limit and figuring out what that limit is. And then, in a way, just cocooning myself and coming out as a new butterfly, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? I don't know. Can you use that? I don't know if you guys can use that. Sometimes what you see on camera is not the true reality of YouTubers. At the end of the day, they're human, just like you. They feel things, so when they see a mean comment, it affects them. You'd be surprised. There's a very human side to what is happening behind the camera. There's still a kid who wants to make the world a better place, and they're trying to do it with their videos.
And sparkle it up.
Deep down, we all know that we're not perfect. We struggle with our body image. We struggle with mental health and sustainability. And we sometimes behave in ways where we're not really proud and it causes drama. But what personally makes me the most proud of being a part of this community is witnessing how we all rally together to support our viewers and fellow creators who face discrimination, bullying, self-doubt, or crisis. At the end of the day, we're all here for each other.
How do you feel?
Like $1 million. I don't know.
The community is the world to me. The community is the reflection of the world. They're the reason why I'm still here. I wake up thinking about what they want to watch, and I want to make the community better, so I have to be better.
Thank you so much for watching.
I hope you guys enjoyed this video.
I will see you guys in tomorrow's video. Bye.
Here we are, 15 years later, and I'm ready to kick off the first ever show that celebrates how massive, how mainstream, how empowering, uplifting, inspiring, and inclusive this community I call home is. I cannot be any prouder to say, welcome to Beauty Fest.
One of the best beauty tips I've ever received. I use cortisone cream, put it on a pimple, I have one here, and then, this is the magic trick. I take a Band-Aid. Looks a bit crazy, but if you leave it on for an hour, it kind of sucks out the impurities, and I notice that it takes it out straight away.
Never drag your skin when you're applying skincare, but pat instead.
If you've got stick straight lashes that don't want to hold a curl, honey, take your eyelash curlers and a lighter and heat up the metal part of the curler. Let it cool down enough so you don't burn your eyelids, but let it be warm enough so that it's actually warm enough to hold the curl and push those babies up. You'll have curly lashes for days, honey.
A rock star once told me to add a bit of fuchsia to your bottom lip, and it makes them look juicy. And you smudge them around.
If you want that really nice, snatched, lifted, fierce face, just pull your hair up really tight, especially in these corner parts, and just pull that back, and you are fierce and ready to go.
blow dry upside down for extra volume.
There is nothing worse than leaving the house looking a bit cakey and having your makeup sort of wear off through the evening or through the day. So, lots of setting spray. It just feels like an angel's spit.
Exfoliating your lips with your toothbrush.
I love taking a white shimmery highlighter with a fluffy brush, and I just like to apply that right in my inner corners. I love how bright and open it makes my eyes look, and it just adds a little extra pop to such a simple look.
Using the Cheek Me Later on your lips, it just gives your lips a pop of color without too much.
Instead of putting tape on your face to get like a nice cat eye shape, you can just use a makeup brush and just and get yourself a perfect line.
Taking a pair of false eyelashes and literally just chopping it in half. And then I just place this on like the outer corner. Obviously I have hella thick lashes on right now, but doing that helps to lift the eye so much. I love it.
Next up, we have a super special beauty routine starring three YouTube creators, Asia Jackson, Sylvia Gowning, and Nylea Devorah. Right now, they're here in this Google Hangout. 3 weeks ago, we sent all of them the exact same products that Pharrell Williams uses in his skincare routine and asked them to follow his regime step by step. Now they think they're gonna be doing it themselves, but what they don't know is that we invited the leading expert in Pharrell skincare to join us.
Present.
And when I give him the cue, he'll crash the Hangout and give these YouTubers a tutorial himself. You ready, Pharrell?
Just give me the cue.
All right, I'm going in. Hey guys.
Hey, Derek.
Thank you so much for doing this. But before we see your routines, first things first, how do you think Pharrell manages to look like he's never aged?
The internet has some interesting theories on how Pharrell never ages.
I heard one about like placenta pills. And I was like, what are those? So I researched it. A lot of people joke that it like gives you superpowers. So I mean, honestly, that could
yeah, it could be that, or he's just found the fountain of youth and just hasn't told any of us about it yet.
Where can I get a hold of placenta pills? Is the question. I need those. Is there a black market for it? Like I don't know where you.
Like
would
how would you even go about that? You know, he probably definitely does like DIY at home facial recipes, like some crazy facials with like mayo or like avocado or something like that, or he's like a full-on vampire or a robot.
Ah, funny you should mention vampire because I did find this meme on the internet.
At what point do we accept that Pharrell is a vampire? He looks the same. 2013, 1990.
He's aging backwards.
This is great. Some very valid points you're making here, guys. But before you do the routine, someone special wants to come in and say hi. Bye, guys.
Let's do it.
Who's the special guest?
Wait a minute.
That's a simulation.
Did you hear everything we were just talking about?
Yeah.
So you heard about the placenta pills.
That, mayonnaise, all kinds of... Yeah. First of all, you all are beautiful. And we do much of the same things. Number one, I think there's just like a strong consideration to like routine and respect for routine. I can see it in all of y'all's faces. First of all, coming from your energy, first and foremost, faces are like the most important part of your communication. So people who take the time to commit to a routine, those are the ones that, you know, those are the ones that walk away with the best results.
But no mayonnaise and no placenta.
This three-step routine. It's a three-step.
Yes, three
We're
steps.
We're excited about it.
The first step is the cleanser. It's called the rice powder cleanser.
It says a coin-sized amount. Ooh, that's not that much at all. I feel like this would last a lot.
Well, that's what you'll see. Once you add the water, there's something that's kind of like alchemical that happens.
Oh, whoa.
Yeah.
I love that. Have you seen that? It's like mixing into a little mixture here.
It's gotta look like this.
Okay, gotcha. It like foams up a little bit?
Yeah. Come on, we're doing it together.
I'm going in on this powder.
Pharrell, I have a question.
Yes.
For you. Who are some of your skin idols? Like people that have just aged really nicely and you look at their skin and you're just like, skin goals, you know?
It's like, you're like me?
Yeah.
Angela Bassett, Viola Davis. Oh, yeah. Her skin is just unbelievable. Okay, exfoliator time.
I love that, the pump.
rub that in, and you'll feel it instantly.
I'm feeling it too.
Do you do anything other than like a skincare to kind of like keep yourself feeling young or like centered? Like, is it meditation? Do you take breaks from work often? Like, how do you keep yourself sane?
So I love this question, Asia, because it's so important. It's a spiritual one. Number one, I do need to take a vacation. That's why I'm going to do that very soon. I haven't been on a vacation in 2.5 years, right?
Ooh.
I do meditate every day. Listen. A hot bath for 30 minutes will close anyone's pores. So here's the humidifying cream. So you get the effect of being dewy, but you don't like feel hot and sweaty because the sensation is very important.
Like each product feels like an experience.
And it's only 3 minutes.
Why was it so important for you to have it be so fast?
As soon as you start talking about it, it's like, okay, well, how long is this gonna take?
Right.
You know, for this uncomfortable, what might be uncomfortable, right? Until you realize you're actually gonna enjoy it. Because there's something very sacred about cleaning yourself. If I feel like I can get a prayer in, man, I try to get as much extra credit as I can with the universe. Whenever I feel like I can be useful or helpful to someone else, I try to do it, right? I'm not perfect. I'm a human being. But I know who I work for. Sometimes just taking that sacred time to cleanse oneself is also an opportunity to cleanse the other aspects of your being. For us, for men, like there's always been these stigmas around facials and taking care of your face, and we gotta just get past, like that's just so crazy. And why wouldn't a man wanna take care of his face?
Do you think that the beauty industry will become unisex eventually?
100%. This is the age of Aquarius. It's all about like spirit. People rarely identify as their actual names online. They have like a username that's usually more reflective of like an aspect of their spirit or who they are. It's gonna be less and less about like these things that separate us and more about connecting with someone than what gender has done in the past, you know? Because you're a woman, it was assumed that you wanna do this or you're not gonna do that. Gone are the days that you can put that in a box. And we want that for every spiritual identity. That's what human race is all about.
Yeah.
Do you guys agree or disagree?
Oh, 100% agree. And I see it too and feel it too.
It's such a pleasure to meet you all. And man, maybe we can do this again.
We got us some food.
I mean, you guys are the professionals. I can learn something from you.
You did amazing. Your first routine is great.
Thank you. So grateful to you ladies.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please be blessed.
I just met Pharrell. Just did a video with Pharrell. Just did my skincare routine with Pharrell.
Oh my God, that was amazing. My skin feels so great. Feels better than ever. It's literally glowing.
My skin feels amazing. I'm still like on cloud 9.
I can't believe I had the opportunity to talk to Pharrell. He's even cooler than I ever expected.
I don't normally get starstruck, but it's Pharrell, you know.
We are thrilled to be participating in this special segment of Beauty Fest dedicated to all things 90s.
Everyone enjoying the show? Next up, we have a special member of the YouTube community, the one, the only...
Emma Chamberlain. What's up, Beauty Fest? Woo!
So, you had quite a day last week.
You and your team sent me a bunch of fun, interesting beauty products. I tried them all out, and you're in trouble for some of them. There were a few things in there that like ruined my day, but I still had fun. And some of them, I feel like I'm actually gonna add into my routine. So it was like, there was good and bad, okay?
Well, that's good news, and thank you for filming the experience, because right now, I'm gonna film you reacting to your reactions.
We're gonna watch it right now?
Yes, this is gonna be a review video of your review video.
Stop. It's a reaction inception?
Yes. A react inside a react video. What could be more YouTube-y than that?
I don't think anything.
All right, let's hit it.
I'm ready.
I've received my magical mystery box from my best friend, Derek.
Best friend.
Let's start out with the first package. Ooh, we have the e.l.f. Beauty Shield Antioxidant Enriched Skin Protection Recharging Magnetic Mask Kit. Wow. What? I don't get what this means. I have no idea what I'm getting myself into here. You know what? I'm not gonna do it all over my face because I'm slightly afraid of it, so I'm just gonna cover like one cheek. As you can see here on the box, it looks like the magnet. This is like a magnet, it pulls it off. I'm scared of that, and I'm scared of my skin falling off. So I'm just gonna do a small little area. Maybe right over the zit I just had right there. I don't know if you saw that. Okay, that's enough. I'm terrified of this product. It smells delicious though. So I'm supposed to leave this on for 5-10 minutes. So I'm just gonna sit here and wait. You know what, it's been enough time. I'm too impatient. This is apparently how you remove the mask when you're done, okay? I haven't tried it. You take this magnet. This is a magnet.
Watch this, Derek, you're gonna lose it.
And I guess apparently you put it.
Wait, I'm a genius. I sent you this stuff?
What in the world?
Yeah, like it felt like I was at one of those science museums for kids.
Y'all, it, oh, Derek, this is the coolest sh- ever. My skin feels soft, that's a great sign. I had an absolute ball doing it, so easily 8 out of 10. If no, do you know what? 9.5 out of 10.
Wait.
That is a genius invention.
Okay, hold on, I'm about to check to see if my zit went away. It actually did dry up. Do I think it's a coincidence? Probably. But I want to give the mask.
I think the words you're looking for right now, Emma, are thank you for making your skin better.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Amen.
The removal of the mask is so easy. Like, that was the coolest experience of my life. Moving on. Oh, Uplift Body Sonic Massaging Beauty Roller. Interesting. Oh, sorry. Okay, it's vibrating. The sensation is fine. Like, I mean, I don't hate the sensation of it. I feel like it's making my face a little red. Does my jawline look snatched right now?
Let's be honest, it looks the exact same.
I'm gonna give this a 6 out of 10. I don't think it's necessarily necessary.
That night after I filmed this video, I had a crazy stomach ache. Like it was just rumbling and tumbling in there and not feeling so good. So I brought it out and I massaged my stomach with it, which it said on the packaging that you could do, and it totally helped. So anyway, just wanted to say that the product you sent me came to use later in the day for something we never would have thought it would, and that's a beautiful thing.
So that was fun. Let's open another. Next we have lip appliques. Violet Lips, the pink and black stripes, temporary lip tattoos. Okay, tattoo? I don't like that word when it comes to lips that look like that.
Derek, this was my worst nightmare of a product. Derek, this product ruined my day. It ruined at least 20 minutes of my day, which then carried on until later.
Oh my God, Emma.
Derek, I think I did it wrong. I think I did it wrong.
Oh my God.
Derek, no.
You have every right to be mad at me right now.
Violent lip tattoos.
Yeah, but just wait though. It gets worse.
I would put the other one on for my bottom lip, but I don't want to dig myself deeper into a hole. Oh my God, it's not coming out. Okay, do you know what? That's something I'm gonna handle later. We'll leave it on there for now. I struggle to believe that anybody could make this look good, you know? But I mean, hey, it's possible. So I'm giving it a 2 out of 10 because, I mean, it stuck to my lip. So it did its job there. So I'm gonna go soak my lip in baby oil for 60 to 90 seconds. Please wish me luck. I'm removing this.
Good luck, good luck.
So it's been about 10 minutes. I've been trying to get these last pieces off. They're not budging. They are not budging. Oh, it's oh my God. Oh, we're so close, guys. No, use lipstick. I don't know, I don't care, I hate them. Moving on, Flower Face Up Roller. Ooh, this is fun. This is fun. Okay, so this is what I needed. This is like actually relaxing and nice. I needed something like this after my lip tattoo experience. Ooh, this is nice. It's simple, it's effective. And if you're somebody like me who clenches their jaw when they get stressed, this feels incredible. It's like the simplified version of this. This is like the chill version that's just casual and chill. This is like the X Games mode version. So this is getting a 9 out of 10 for me. It's fun. It's a great stocking stuffer for the holidays. Next, stop. Are you kidding me?
How cool do you look?
Honestly, badass.
The inventions that we've invented as humans never fail to shock me. Like, who comes up with this stuff? Hello? Oh. OMG. I love this. Oh my God. I love this. I literally love this. It's super comfortable. I don't know what it's doing to me right now. That part is a little bit confusing to me. I mean, it feels like it's doing something. In my imagination, it looks fun, it's comfortable. Like, I could walk around with this, I could cook with this, I could clean with this, I could box with this. Like, it's very movable. 9.8 out of 10. I love it.
Oh my God, you have it on right now.
Derek, I love it so much that I'm still wearing it. This thing and I have been inseparable.
Next. Oh no. Oh God. Next, we are doing brow stamp. So, this claims that it's gonna make your eyebrows perfect, evenly shaped, no mess, no fail. I'll be the judge of that. There are two stamps, because you go in here, rub it into the powder. Okay, now you have your eyebrow. Okay, so clearly that was user error. Honestly, it's not that bad. Okay, it's kind of bad. It's not as bad as I thought it would be. Okay, why is my accuracy so bad with this thing? For some reason, I just can't do it properly, but I don't think it's a terrible invention, and I definitely don't think that it's all terribly bad. Like, I mean, this is obviously not looking so great, right? It's not. We know this. But I think it's a good invention, and I think it's a good product. Like, I'm on its team, you know what I'm saying? So I'm gonna give this a 7 out of 10.
Derek, as payment, next time when we hang out, I'm making you put them on. And then you have to see what it's like.
And last but not least, oh God, oh no, oh, I hate this. No, this is, no, oh my God. I am really afraid of this product. Listen to what this is. Chrome tooth polish. Chrome is a tooth polish, just like nail polish. They can be applied to teeth and removed in a matter of seconds and last for up to 24 hours. Why would you want to do this? Why? Well, you know what? I'm not going to be judgmental. Okay, let's give this a try. If this doesn't come off like the lip product, there will be tears. It smells like nail polish. There's no way that this is this poisonous? Derek would never do me that dirty. No way. What? Wait, why is this kind of fun? Wait, why do I actually like this? Stop, why is this kind of sick? Wait, why do I like it? Wait, help, why do I like it? Why is it kind of cool? No, why do I like it? Guys.
That's literally me every time I like meet a guy.
The best thing about that anecdote is that you just compared your love life to an orange tooth. I
Wait, why is it kind of cool? Guys, what is going on? This is honestly crazy. And weirdly, I enjoy how it looks. Like, I can't explain it. This one's a little questionable because orange makes it look like your tooth is rotting, whereas like the blue is kind of cool because it's like clearly not your tooth rotting. This could actually be a really fun accessory. Like, I'm not kidding. I actually think I like this concept so much more than I would have thought. Let's say you're wearing like a all orange outfit and then you like have one orange tooth. Like, it could actually be really cool. Let's see how easy it is to remove though, because that's gonna be very telling. Because if this is hard to get off, then I'm gonna rate this catastrophically bad. Oh, it's not gone. I definitely need to go brush my teeth because the tooth polish is kind of not budging. Nothing to fear.
As you can see, everything is gone. So we are all good. We successfully removed the tooth polish by the end of the day. Derek, you are not going to be punished for this one.
My favorite products would have to be number one, the Dr. Dennis Gross LED face mask thing. This thing is so cool. After that, I would say the e.l.f. magnetic face mask. Super fun experience. Made my skin feel nice and smooth. I have no complaints. I'm gonna keep trying these products over the course of the next few days, and I'll meet back with Derek and we'll discuss.
Oh my God. Thank you so much for doing that. Thank you for being the guinea pig.
At the end of the day, I had a lot of fun, especially because these are things that I normally would not ever have a chance to use or try. You have me covered on all fronts, and I'm so grateful for that, Derek.
Your ultimate fashion and beauty fairy godfather.
Seriously, seriously.
Emma, thank you so much. Beauty festival must go on. I have to call my friend Kevin, but I will FaceTime you right after, and I want to see you in that mask.
Okay, great. Thank you for having me, Derek.
Can I get a forehead kiss?
Anytime, Derek. Anytime.
Are you nervous?
A little bit. Okay. All right, so I'm really excited about this. There is a creator named Bailey Sarian. You may have heard of her because she's one of the biggest breakout channels on YouTube in the past year, and she combines murder and makeup, which are two things that just shouldn't go together, but somehow do. And we're gonna look at the analytics behind her channel and why it's blown up. Hey, Bailey. You ready to do this?
Hi, I'm ready to do this.
So here's the deal. I spent a bunch of time basically going through your YouTube analytics, looking at the data behind your channel and the rise of your channel and what's been popular to help us kind of understand how you became so successful.
I love that.
Sound good?
I love that.
Okay, cool. So the first question before I pull up any interesting charts is, how much time do you spend checking your YouTube analytics?
I pay attention to watch time, and that's usually about it. I feel like staring at analytics was stealing my joy. I really like the content that I make. I have a fun time doing it, and I'm very interested in it. And I started to notice when I was paying attention to my analytics, it was just bringing me down. It was like, no number is ever good enough. I was never doing good enough. I was never gonna be good enough according to these numbers. And it started just to mess with me. So I was like, you know what? I'm just not gonna look anymore. I'm gonna keep doing what I love and let that lead the way.
My goal today is to put the joy back in your analytics. Well, I've also brought some candles here. These are scented, terrible candles, but just to get a little bit of
the vibe,
of a relationship here. The first chart we're gonna look at is the lifetime viewership on your channel. And the first thing you'll notice, there's several years where the line is relatively flat. And it looks that way because you've been so successful in the past year and a half, 2 years. Tell us about that time when sort of the line is flat here.
So in the beginning, I was just making content that was focused on makeup reviews, products, Get Ready With Me, where I was just kind of like sitting and talking. And I really enjoyed it, but it was really hard to stand out in the sea of content creators. I kept trying because I really enjoyed making YouTube videos. I like sitting down and just having a conversation with my viewers.
Yeah, all right, so let's talk about that turning point. You can see here, like 2019 is like where things start really happening, right? So like, let's talk about what happened here.
Well, in 2018, I was heavily following the Chris Watts case. It's a really awful story. I was like so obsessed with it. I had all this built up knowledge about the case. So I just needed to talk about it. And I was like, okay, what if I made a video where I talked about the Chris Watts case and then I did my makeup at the same time just to like keep myself busy, give myself something to do. And I did. And that's where it all began.
Okay, so then what happened here? Do you know what happened here, I should say?
I don't know what happened there.
It's when the Cannibal Cafe video came out. What was like, what that really seemed to have taken off going back and like looking at the data here. So like what do you attribute that?
I just think the overall story had a lot of people thinking and a lot of people talking and engaging. He was asking for anyone willing to be eaten. And the fact that, again, I was doing my makeup and talking about cannibals, I think it just kept people watching.
Yeah, so did anything change for you when this started happening, when you started to get this response?
Yes, I was like, okay, I need to focus on more cannibals.
So let's go to the next chart. So this is 2020. There's this gradual like increase that's not associated with necessarily any specific video, right? Like in mid 2020.
I think by that time I kind of had like my system in place where I had my intro, I knew what I was gonna say, I came in more confident.
We're gonna do a little detour here for a second. So this is 2019 into 2020. I noticed one thing that was pretty interesting that was common about the videos that had the lowest views in the first 24 hours and the ones that had the most views in the first 24 hours. Can you guess what the common threads between those two things were?
Murder.
That is right. It's like, basically, all your more traditional beauty videos were getting fewer views in the first 24 hours than all of the murder videos were. Because your audience like kind of was like in on this, like with you. They're like, yeah, like more of this, please. Interestingly, when you look at this from your click-through rate, and when you look at the highest click-through rate thumbnails versus the lower ones, like, actually, it really is not just about the thumb, it's actually about the topic.
Yeah, I just am surprised that Mothman video is number one, because I thought that one didn't perform that well.
The click-through rate doesn't always correlate with overall popularity, right? Like, actually, there are a lot of videos that people might click on and then they might not stick around for. Which videos do you think have the highest percent viewed?
Jeffrey Dahmer, for sure.
Satanic Panic or A Cult Hidden in Town. So I went and looked. So this is the retention, this is what we call the absolute retention of the video. So basically, in your analytics, you can go in and see, like, where did the audience start to drop off at different points? And you can see yours is like pretty steady and pretty high, but there's a couple of spikes. And the spikes usually happen when people are like rewatching something. So just tell me what you think of this. So at the 6 minute mark, there's this like kind of bump where you describe what happens when someone gets hanged.
When someone is hanged, the body weight pulls the chin toward the rope so that the rope mark is always above the Adam's apple.
A pretty morbid thing.
Oh,
but like,
God.
It's like, okay, like people are like, what? They're like, wait, what is she talking about? And then the bumps at the like later, in the later part of the video comes in about 18 minutes and 19 minutes. It's actually when you're like cracking jokes. And one of them, you talk about how you like had bad cramps and that's why you're being so sassy in that part of the video. And then in the other part, you were like, you started laughing about something and then you're like,
it's not funny.
Because you're like in the middle of this like serious thing. And I think it's just like, I think that speaks to the like reason that a lot of people tune in, right? Is not like just for the case, but it is for like the Bailey version of the story.
That's me in a nutshell. I'm talking about like some very morbid stuff, but I got bad cramps and I'm in a bad mood. So like, that is the definition of who I am as a person. Okay, so I need to sprinkle in some more like humor.
All right, and then we got one last chart. This is the same scatter plot that we looked at earlier, but this is actually looking at a longer window of time. So it basically takes us into this year. I think it's pretty amazing that like, okay, so we're 2 years since you started down this like path of, you know, making this kind of hybrid, you know, murder makeup content. And your videos are actually doing the best ever.
Of course, it's scary to think about trying something new. But I mean, if I honestly was super passionate about something else, 100% I would try it. Like, you, again, you don't have anything to lose. And it's like, I think a lot of my subscribers kind of come for the personality and the way that I talk about things. So I think a lot of them would go with it. I don't know though.
Yeah.
I don't know, I struck gold, I feel like. How often do you hear about YouTubers just trying something on a whim for fun and like it being super successful? Most of the times I've talked to other creators, it's like, oh, I tried this thing, totally bombed. Or they get stuck in this hamster wheel and they're too afraid to try something, or they're just comparing themselves and the numbers and all of that. And I literally did everything opposite. I didn't look at the numbers. I just did whatever I wanted and I'm still doing it. Like, how often do you hear creators saying that, you know? So it's just, I got very lucky.
All right, Bailey, before we go, what should people be on the lookout for with your channel this year?
So I've been working on a lot of new exciting things that I'm not allowed to mention yet, but it's kind of like in the same realm and it should be fun and something that I've been wanting to do. So I'm trying something new. Okay, and it's gonna be good, I think. We'll see. I love my confidence. What now?
I mean, honestly, I think just like stop, like keep not looking at your analytics. Okay. And just keep doing your thing, because it seems to be working pretty well.
Yeah, I'll just get more candles. That's what I'm good at.
Beauty. Fest.
Hey Beauty Fest, it's Chris Appleton.
Hey Beauty Fest, I'm Ashley Graham.
Hi Beauty Fest.
Hi Beauty Fest.
I'm Evie.
It's me, Violet Chachki.
This is Jessica Alba.
One of my favorite YouTube creators right now.
The YouTuber I'm loving right now.
One of my favorite creators in the platform.
Naomi Campbell, her guest list is mind-blowing. Basically, she calls and you answer. She gets anyone she wants and the conversations are super interesting. And candid, I feel like you just spill your guts to Naomi.
J-Lo, I love watching her channel. I think she's got some great insights into her working career. Like when she talks about her movies, all the behind the scenes stuff. Yeah, it's super fun to watch.
Jackie Ina. I feel like when she uploads a video, my best friend just came over and we're talking about beauty, we're talking about makeup, we're chilling, and I just feel like, yes.
I actually have two right now. One is Patrick Starr. Love. And the other one is Hyrum.
Bailey Sarian, just the way she can do her makeup while having these insane, crazy stories with her Mystery Makeup Mondays is just captivating. I am her biggest fan ever.
I am loving GotMix YouTube channel. It's everything makeup, glamour, drag, fashion, and everything that I love.
All right, now I want to hear from all of you. Who is your favorite YouTube star?
Hey everyone, my name is Grace Guan and I'm a partner manager here at YouTube, which means I get to work with our top fashion and beauty creators to empower their growth and contributions to this amazing community. I grew up on YouTube watching all of the classic beauty formats from tutorials to first impressions, reviews, and all the good stuff. So today I am so excited to be hosting my own dream collaboration with Anna Akana, Nabella Noor, and Deepika Mutyala. Hi everyone!
Hi!
Y'all, it's May, which means it's Asian American and Pacific Islander Heritage Month here in the US. Mm-hmm. And there's so much to celebrate in the community. I found so many of my role models here on YouTube, like a lot of you I grew up watching. And I know historically it's been an outlet for creators who weren't able to break through traditional Hollywood media. But recently, we've also been experiencing this uptick in hate crimes across the Asian community. So I really wanted to talk with you all. We're all of Asian descent. Can I hear a little bit more about your upbringings, how that's shaped you into who you are today? And maybe Anna, we can start with you.
I am a mutt. I'm like a mix of all things, but I very much strongly identify with being Japanese since I spent a chunk of my childhood there actually going to a public school and learning the language. And, you know, I love being Japanese American, and I have found that that's really influenced the way I've grown up as Japanese, which is so focused on community, so focused on helping other people, so focused on being a part of the collective, versus American, which is all about individual freedom. And I feel like I got the best of both worlds because it made me like learn how to be a compassionate human being who also had a sense of self.
So I am Indian American and I grew up here in Houston, Texas. And I really, really feel like my whole life, I changed everything about myself to fit into the beauty standards I saw around me. It's just really cool to be at a place now where I'm confidently in my brown eyes and dark brown, black hair. It's just so crazy to me now to think about how much I tried to change about myself, because the things that make me identify with my Indian culture are my like the most favorite things about myself now, but it took like a solid 30 years to get there.
So I was just gonna say, like, I relate so hard to trying to be white growing up and trying to look white and falling for the idea of beauty.
I totally, again, agree and relate so much. I grew up in a small white town where I still live, and it's predominantly white and very conservative. And I'm Bangladeshi American, first generation. So there was a lot of confusion growing up and not enough confidence in my own skin. I genuinely remember waking, like going to bed every night and waking up wishing that I was a different race, that I was white, that my hair was like blonde, that my eyes would be blue, that my name would be like pronounceable, right? And so that was my dream. I would waste every birthday candle wish on that. And it took so many years to finally realize that being different is not something to be ashamed of. It's something to embrace. And finally, through the internet, I discovered like there's so many other brown girls like me that have experienced the same thing.
Anybody else grow up with a mustache and like,
oh my like God,
so depressed. I used to cry. I remember there was this memory about this white boy, and he was like, oh, Deepika's so mature for her age. She's so mature that she's growing a mustache already.
I'm going to go find where he is and give him a piece of my mind.
I'm pretty sure he's doing nothing with his life, so it's fine.
I had a guy who like literally would make fun of me for being, I was so hairy. I had like a unibrow. I have like really intense arm hair that I like lasered off, but they used to call me Wolverine's bride in middle school. And like, I would cry and like beg my mom, like, please take me to get my brows like waxed or let me shave my arm or something.
I totally, oh my gosh, it's like, you know, this is very therapeutic because everything you guys are saying, I'm like, okay, they're not going to believe it, but same. Because my brows were, first of all, I had a unibrow, which in retrospect, I really wish I would have like embraced more. But I also had like really thick brows, and now I can never get them back to that thickness because all I would do is try to make them as thin as my, you know, my white friends.
Yeah.
Jump in and say like, I love seeing how diverse the Asian community is, even in this like little microcosm of our conversation. Like, it's like what they say, like, we are not a monolith. You might think that Asians all look the same, like that's kind of like the way that we're made fun of, but we all come from such different backgrounds and cultures, but have this shared experience of like being othered, mm-hmm. or our families come across another country at some point. So that's so cool. I have a question that I'm personally very curious to hear the answer to. So I'm a child of immigrants, and my parents were very hesitant about me potentially pursuing any like non-traditional career path. I initially wanted to go into art and like studio art, and they were like, that doesn't really sound very employable, so maybe go get a different degree in something else and see if you still like are passionate about that. For you guys, like, how did your family or your parents respond in any sort of way at all into you going into creative field and something as unknown at the time when you started as YouTube and like social media? Oh, maybe Nabella, I saw you nodding. So you,
I feel like Deepika, and I know both of you are going to resonate with this thought. I grew up with there being three paths you can pick between.
Oh my
God. So you're either going to be a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer.
Oh,
and yeah. I very much like growing up, that was it. Those are my options. And I had to get an arranged marriage. Like everything was like prescribed. I was at a doctor's office. Everything is prescribed for me. And so growing up and discovering that I had this creative bug, this creative itch that I could not shake. And that no matter how much my mom wanted it to be a hobby, felt like it was my everything, was really tough. And so I did do what they wanted me to do. I got my bachelor's degree. I worked in social work as I was preparing for my LSATs to go to law school. You know, everything was really going to plan. Yeah. And then I wanted to work for the UN, and I was gonna, you know, make my parents proud. And I had always had this passion for social issues. So anyway, I'm doing this, but then on the side, I'm making these YouTube videos, I'm posting on social media, and I'm growing a following. And, you know, I was really bringing representation for Bangladeshi Americans, which is so, so underrepresented. And I remember asking my mom and my dad, and I was saying, guys, like, I have my degree, I'm getting ready to go to law school. Is it cool if I just try to see where this would take me full time? And at first they were hesitant. Then they went back to Bangladesh for a vacation, and people were stopping them, asking if they were Nabila Noor's parents.
Oh,
and the pride they felt like just made their hearts so open to the idea. And they had never imagined that would happen. So then they were like, you know what? They're like, maybe. How about you try for a little? And now I'm here. But what's so wild is my original dream of working for the UN ended up coming true because I sat in a meeting at the UN talking about how I can use my platform to talk about social issues pertaining to my community. So it all became full circle. And now I can say that I've lived out all of my dreams.
That's amazing. So I also love how Asian parents change their tune when you're successful in other guys. They're like, oh, okay. All right. Other people think you're successful. Okay.
Yeah.
it took me being on the Today Show and my dad hearing it from his friends and things like that for him to be like, maybe she is onto something. It's one of those things that in hindsight I now realize, but very similar to you. Like I thought my life path was work at L'Oreal, go to Harvard Business School, make my dad happy so he could tell all of his friends, and then start my own beauty brand. But after I did the L'Oreal internship, they didn't think I was qualified or a strong enough marketer, and they didn't give me the job. And LOL, because I've now been in a L'Oreal commercial, and like,
here we go.
It's these
I moments. Feel like my dad too, like, I feel like it's sort of the same, right? Like they were always like, you're going to be a doctor, or, and you're going to go into the military. So like my whole life, I kind of was going to ROTC camps and summer camps for the military and like prepping to be like a police officer. And then my sister passed away when I was 17, and my parents were like, oh shit, it was a suicide. So my parents were really reevaluating like their parenting and what they had done. And so when I was 19, I was like, actually, I want to go into stand up. I want to become an actor. I've never wanted to really be in the military. And they were so supportive. And they were just like, we see this makes you happy, and all we want now is for our two children to do whatever it is that makes them happy. So they've been amazing and supportive. But I mean, how are you guys feeling? Like, I feel like my whole life I struggled very much with identifying with being an Asian woman and being proud of that. And then now to finally actually be proud of who I am. And now Asian people are being attacked more than ever, like post 9/11, like brown people everywhere were fucking attacked. And post COVID-19, now Southeast Asian everyone is being attacked. Like, it's such a bitter, sweet, terrible thing, I feel like.
I feel like, you know, living in a post 9/11 America as a Muslim American was terrifying. And I was so young, and my family was targeted so many times. And it really feels scary and eerie to feel like history is somewhat repeating itself. And just seeing the Asian community suffer in this way, and just, it breaks my heart. I flash back to times when I was younger, right after 9/11, neighbors would come to our door and my neighbor friends would tell me, my parents said I can't hang out with you anymore because you're Muslim. Oh, you know, God. Being told, yeah, genuinely with conviction, you know, I was little, you know, and these kids were little, and that hate was taught. And I remember, you know, being told so many times, go back to where you came from. Mm-hmm. And my mom, again, we live in a very, very non-diverse town. So growing up, my mom, who would wear the hijab, would be the target of so many hateful comments. And we've as a family dealt with a lot that would make anybody scared. I had to legally change my original last name because it was a name that was one of the names of one of the terrorists who flew into the Twin Towers. Wow. So I had to change my name. And it was really, really scary because we would go to the airport and I would always get flagged as a red flag, and I would always have extensive searches. And so life became more paranoid. And it's interesting to see that happen again, you know?
Yeah.
So the interesting thing for me is I'm not Muslim American, but it didn't matter because people assumed my family was racism. I do laugh at it because it just is so idiotic, and you know, they just assume if you have brown skin post 9/11 that you must have had something to do with it, or your family had something to do with it. I mean, people made jokes right. in school as if it was like funny, as if I didn't feel the same hurt as an American that the rest world was going through. And I wanted to fit in. So to be honest, I just remember like laughing it off too, and going home being bitter about the color of my skin and actively wanting to avoid the sun right. so I could look like the non-terrorist at my school. And it's so crazy that that's the kind of mindset I had growing up. Seeing what's happening right now with the hate crimes, it's like, yeah, it feels like very PTSD. And you know, as much as we are so different as Asian Americans, there is that unity I feel between us, and it feels like an attack on one of us is an attack on all of us. And that's what I'm feeling right now. And it breaks my heart. It really does.
For me, it was always weird because I grew up predominantly, I mean, I was
in the South as a child, but I was stupid, so I didn't realize I was Asian for a lot of that. Like, I thought I was just like a white person who had dark hair. And I mean, after that, I went to Japan and then Korea and then Hawaii, which are all Asian dominated places. Mm-hmm. So I didn't really encounter like racism until I was like 16 and I moved back to California and went to high school here. And my first day of school, this guy was like, go back to China. And he like spit at me. And I genuinely laughed at him because I was like, oh, honey, I'm Japanese. Like, that's so embarrassing for you that you can't tell. Like, I didn't realize until I was like way into my 20s how bad racism on the mainland is.
Seeing history repeat itself in this way in so many ways. After tragedy, it's who do we blame?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. When I say history repeating itself, I really mean this idea that when tragedy occurs and you're not white, then we have to blame the entire community. And that's so toxic and scary. And it's so, I'm very thankful that we have this platform now where we are all online and we can speak up for our communities. And we can, because we didn't have that growing up. Like, I didn't have someone that was Muslim American in the media or a Bangladeshi that was saying like, this is wrong. Mm-hmm. Stop attacking our people.
Grace, I'm curious for you, like when the Asian attacks started increasing, was there anything you changed? Like, I stopped going to the Whole Foods by my house because I was getting such hostile looks that I started only going to the Japanese grocery store. But was there anything that changed in your life?
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, I think what you're saying about, it's almost like having the talk with your parents. And I've been living with my grandparents as well, and they're over 80 years old. They don't speak any English. They've been so afraid of getting the virus that they like haven't stepped foot outside our house basically in the past year until they were vaccinated earlier in like February. And it feels so heartbreaking to me because it's like they've been waiting over a year to go outside and to like go to the beach or like go on a walk. And I start to have fear for them that if we leave our grandparents somewhere, because, you know, my grandpa's not very mobile, he's got a bad knee, we usually just like find a bench to like drop them off at and then we go and explore somewhere on a day trip. And the other day we took them to the beach and we left them up at the front. And I was like, what if someone just gets angry at them for no reason and blames them for bringing COVID to this country and decides to attack some literally harmless, vulnerable 80-year-old grandparents? And it's weird. It's like, this is our home. Like, I was born and raised in America. My parents have been living here now longer than they've lived in China. And it just is that whole idea of the perpetual foreigner. Like, we are always going to be seen as other. We're always going to be seen as foreign, no matter how, I don't know, like ingrained being American is into myself and how much I always like want to stand up for America. And I just wanted to like say these stats because I just think they're crazy when you try to think of the numbers. Like, in 2020, hate crimes toward Asians spiked by 150% in major U.S. cities. Police Department saw a 1900% increase in anti-Asian hate crime incidents. And these are like only the reported ones, right? Like, so many go unreported. Women of Asian descent in particular and the elderly have been disproportionately targeted, with 68% of hate crime reports coming from Asian women. And then, of course, in March, there was the horrific shooting of 6 Asian women out of the total 8 individuals murdered in Atlanta. And Anna, I know you made a really powerful video about this called 6 Asian Women Have Been Murdered. How did it feel to write and film and share that message with your audience? I mean, I watched it and I was just like in tears.
Yeah, you could not help but cry.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Thank you. It was really hard because I think we were all like, I mean, all of us collectively were in shock. And I think until to me, it was like, I understood like and empathized so much with Black Lives Matter. But the shooting in Atlanta made me realize, oh, I have no idea how the Black community feels, because this feels so insane and so personal. Mm-hmm. And it really helped. Mm-hmm. Helped me, I think, empathize with all the other movements for equality going on. But I mean, it took me a couple of days to write it because I wanted to add to the conversation and try to humanize what was going on, because the blatant racial gaslighting that was happening online of how this wasn't about race, this was about sex addiction, stop making it about race, was like so infuriating. I actually only did one take of the poem, and that's what ended up going online. I did one, and I was like, I don't think I have it in me to do that again. And everyone was like, I think that was fine. Like, you only needed the one. But I don't know. I think, like, I try to be very hopeful in believing that the media that we put out, like, and for you, Deepika and Novella, like, you guys being yourselves and being a model for other brown women and other Asian women, like, I think that's all we can do. And I feel right. so powerless in the face of hate that I'm just like, all I can do is try to make art that makes people understand who we are and sympathize with us and have a connection with us. Like, someone was telling me the other day, when they were creating the atom bomb, the only reason they decided not to bomb Kyoto and they chose Hiroshima is because one of the scientists had actually been to Kyoto. Mm-hmm. So, like, that scientist had a connection there, so they chose another city. And I was like, that's what it takes. You need to have that level of connection with people to change their minds. And so hopefully we can all do that by just putting ourselves out there and with our art and our authenticity.
I'm so honored to have been able to do this chat with you guys.
Yay. I wish I was hugging everyone and we were in a room together. Soon enough.
Thank you all so much for joining this conversation. I've seriously learned so much from all of you. I feel like you all are my soul sisters now. We've just had this enriching time, so fulfilling. And I just really appreciate you so much. This conversation was so beautiful. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you guys. Thank you all. It was so much fun.
Do you want to see the best beauty tip that I've ever received? I'm about to give it to you right here, right now. It's confidence. Confidence is key.
Putting mascara on your bottom lashes completely changes your look. So I just take my little mascara here. Automatically, it just makes your eye pop so much more. It's like one of my favorite tips, and it's so simple again, but it makes such a big difference.
Press and roll the foundation into the skin. You press it and then roll it, press it and roll it. And same thing, setting your powder that you have to lock the foundation in with the powder, pressing and rolling, and that is how you get a flawless foundation.
If you're not priming, you're committing a crime. Not to prime is a crime. Thank you.
One of my favorite beauty tips is the Foreo Beauty Device. This thing is amazing. It's an LED thermoactivated beauty mask. So basically, you can take the mask, this one is called Glow Addict, you put it on your face, and then this is thermoactivated, so it heats up and just gets the mask really deep into your skin. It's incredible, it makes your skin glow, and yeah.
One of my absolute favorite makeup tips that I've been doing for years now is layering up different formulas of mascaras, because then you get the nice volumized lashes, you get them lengthened, and when you find a combination of two mascaras that just work beautifully together, it's just magic.
If you just take your eyeshadow, extend it out past your brow, you automatically get a lifted fox eye. Try it out.
Sunscreen. We have to use to wear sunscreen every single day, and not just in the morning, but we have to reapply throughout the day. Now, two fingers. This is all you need to protect your entire face throughout the day.
I have to say the best beauty tip that I've ever received is to love yourself. You should definitely try it. Maybe it feels awkward at first for you, but after you've done it, it's the best feeling, and nobody can tell you otherwise because it's
Hi, Beauty Fest. I'm Gwyneth Paltrow.
And I'm Addison Ray.
And we are thrilled to be participating in this special segment of Beauty Fest dedicated to all things 90s. I personally love the 90s, of course, and so I'm thrilled that they've been making a comeback.
I'm not gonna lie, I definitely take a lot of my inspiration from the 90s, and you've had some really iconic looks. Apparently, YouTube has found many moments where we accidentally twinned.
Oh dear. I gotta see this. This look was from, I did a movie called Emma, mm-hmm. an adaptation of a Jane Austen novel, and it was kind of my first like really big starring role. And this was the premiere.
I love this look.
You do?
Yes, I love the lip.
The thin eyebrows though, I'm not that into
see,
that.
See, my mom has thin eyebrows because of that trend, and she never let me pluck mine because of that.
You're smart. Oh.
Me.
You wore it better.
Oh my gosh. I was on set for my first music video.
Oh, really?
That was really fun, yeah. I like want to wear the hairstyle more often.
Yeah, okay. This is when I had brown hair. I was doing a movie called Bounce. I think this was afterwards, but I sort of was enjoying being a brunette for a while.
I'm a natural brunette. See? Oh. That's like my natural hair color.
That's really pretty. That's a beautiful hair color. You look beautiful.
I love the updo. The updo's so cute.
Yours is better than mine. Mine is too high.
No, I like yours better for sure.
Mine's like a pom-pom on the top of my head. Okay, so this is MTV Video Music Awards, 1996. This is a legendary Tom Ford.
And here's me in the bathroom. Just got out of the stall, washed my hands, and was like, let me take a quick pic.
Yes, it's
very... You did this better, for sure. We don't have to argue on that one.
So, do we have time to do this? We do? Okay. Should I tell her what we're doing?
What are we doing? I'm nervous. What is this?
I have to admit to you that I've been making a little plan behind your back. YouTube and I have been formulating a little, I don't know if it's a surprise, but a little something.
Okay.
Are you nervous?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to give you the ultimate 90s makeover.
Oh my gosh, okay, yay, that's good news. I'm excited, oh my gosh. What do you mean by that though?
Well, I'm really bad at doing makeup, so I'm not gonna do it, okay. But I'll take you through some key 90s
oh my gosh.
Makeup.
Yay. Okay, I'm excited.
Oh my goodness, you look amazing.
Thank you.
This is really spectacular, I have to say.
Thank you.
It's really stunning.
I love it. I loved it on you, so being able to wear it is so exciting.
I think this is the G-Label version that we made in homage to my red Tom Ford. It still works.
I love it, it's so pretty. I'm like feeling like I'm you. What's your best beauty tip or trick?
I really believe in great skin as the foundation for beauty. I feel like you know, staying really hydrated and exercising and eating good, nutritious foods. We have this moisturizer at Goop. It's called Glow Lotion, and it's a really nice, because I don't wear a lot of foundation or anything normally, and it just gives you like a really nice kind of hydrated look. So that's that and mascara, I would say, are my two.
I am a mascara-holic.
You are?
Mascara. It's like if I had to have one product forever, it would be mascara. And also, I love glowing, so I'm gonna try out that glow.
I'm gonna give you one. I'm gonna give you one. Do you make mascara when you're makeup line?
I do. It's called Lash Snack. It's really good. It's like very lengthening and like spread out.
Voluminous. That's good. Okay.
Yeah, it's really like light but also buildable. So I love something that can like give me some drama too, you know?
That's so great. So you're the real expert, so you have to tell me what your best beauty tip is.
Okay, my best beauty tip is probably using using lipstick as blush.
Oh.
And so I'll put it like on my nose.
Oh my God.
That's like my favorite.
I'm having visions of me trying to do that and looking like a clown at the end of the.
Sometimes I do, but I'm like, I kind of like it. I like a sun-kissed like beach. Mm. I love looking like I have a little sunburn.
Yeah, it looks good. How did you decide to start a makeup line? It's very impressive and entrepreneurial.
Thank you. So my mom was a makeup artist when I was little.
Okay.
And so that always kind of inspired me to get into makeup. And then I also grew up in competitive dance. So like
so
dancing,
did my daughter.
You know, performing, always had to do your makeup. Even at like a young age, I was like wearing bright red lipstick to my competitions and stuff.
And those big strips of eyelashes.
The massive ones too, yeah. And I feel like just growing up around that, I always loved makeup. I like did my friends' makeup in high school for prom and stuff. Like they would come over and like give me $15 and I'm like, all right, time to do their makeup. Do you have any advice for dealing with fame at a young age?
Oh, I don't envy you that you're so famous now in the days of social media and how much extra pressure there is. When I got famous and I was about 22 years old, there were no cell phones, there was no internet. You know, you could fall out of a club and no one would video you. There were no, you know, gossip sites all over the world in that way. So I admire you for being brave through it all and like continuing to bring your art and your sparkle through to your fans and the world. And I would just like stay really close to the people who know you really well and love you for you. Because one of the best benefits that I've had in my life is staying best friends, like with my best friend since kindergarten or seventh grade, or my brother or my family. Yeah. And those people always keep you really grounded to what's real, and they keep you closer to yourself.
I guess like you get so used to like being around so many people all the time, and you're like, I need to be, give everyone a part of me. But then there's like parts of me that I'm like, definitely want to keep, I guess, in mind too, and like remembering, like where I started and where I came from, and like my initial, like, I guess, desire to do everything, because I don't want to let anyone down. And that's kind of like, I think that sometimes where the pressure comes in, because I just want to make sure I'm like very active and making everyone happy, but then also trying to find a balance.
You have to do what's right for you, and your fans will wait for your next post. Like, don't ever compromise your health and your mind, your heart, and your spirit for anybody else. You're the most important one.
That means a lot, from you especially. Okay, this is so much fun, and I am obsessed with this outfit, but I'm so excited about
these
products.
You can take it home. Okay, so this, before we get to the Goop products, if you want to complete your 90s look, there was one particular product that we all wore in the 90s, and it was this. MAC Spice lip liner.
My mom wears that lip liner to this day. I am so happy about this. I wanted my own. Yay!
You can put lip liner on without a mirror?
I think I can.
Wow.
I'm like,
you're a prodigy. Okay. You're doing it perfectly. That's crazy. I don't know how you're doing that. Oh my god, this is so 90s too. You're right on the line. That's wild.
Okay, can I do it?
Perfectly.
Okay, 90s look.
That's it. And then you also need like a really matte powder, of course.
Oh my goodness. Now it's so dewy, I feel like. You know, everyone like is all about being so dewy.
I know. It was in the 90s, it was all about the matte. It's actually really pretty. You have a great face for the 90s look.
Thank you.
I think you have a great face for any era, frankly. But when you want to take it off, here, you can use our amazing Getox cleanser.
Yay.
Then this one is the Microderms. This is like a facial in a jar.
Oh, that's
incredible. Perfect. And it'll bring your glow back. And then this is the glow lotion that I was telling you about.
Yay! Oh my gosh, so I get to test this out and see if I'm really glowing.
That's right.
Like you. This was the most fun day ever. Thank you so much for having me and giving me this 90s makeover.
Oh my gosh, you look unbelievable. You're your own 90s icon. You're just pulling it off. It's been so nice to have some time with you.
Thank you so much. And we'll definitely have to do this again.
I got some
amazing advice and makeup tips that I will be using daily. So thank you so much, everyone, for watching Beauty Fest.
What the f*** is up, Beauty Fest? No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. Hello, 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 Beauty Fest. Today's little segment is one that we like to call Ask a Drag Queen. You asked us a bunch of questions, and today we'll be answering our favorites.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all ready? Let's do it.
You ready?
Let's do it.
When was the first time you did drag?
You did it in college.
Ah! You know about me. That's so sweet.
Oh, yeah, you did it at a college drag ball that Peppermint hosted.
Yeah.
And you were wearing that. You were dressed like you was in the cast of 9 to 5. I started doing drag when I was 23 years old.
Yeah, back in the late 80s.
In 2009. So you were just dabbling in the dark arts. I became a sister of the cloth. How did y'all start your drag wardrobe? I have no idea how to start because I'm a big old man and I'm not swimming in cash.
You don't. But a lot of my drag at the beginning was all stuff I got from Rainbow, like literally like $5 shirts. When you start doing drag more, you start building your own identity and what that queen looks like.
My drag really changed once I learned how to sew. Do not be intimidated by the singer, by the sewing machine, by the brother machine. You can learn anything on YouTube.
If you could take one part of drag and snap your fingers to make it happen without you actually having to do the work, what would it be? On three.
I know what mine is.
Let's see if we say the same thing. One, two, three.
Body.
Makeup.
Oh, I'll do body.
Makeup. Oh my God. Are we?
Should we?
We
will be releasing our own line of maquillage.
Yes, Bob and Monet, the siblings we are. We have a makeup line coming out this year, 2021. And it's going to be fierce. We're both wearing colors from our new palettes coming out soon. It's fierce. We've been working really hard on it.
Very hard.
We're very proud of it.
Please keep your eyes out for BOMO Cosmetics coming very, very, BOMO very beauty. Soon. Ooh. BOMO, Bob and Monet.
Yeah.
I'm so excited.
This is dope.
We're going to change the game. Children's cartoons have had an increase in LGBTQ plus characters and characters of color. Do you think this makes a difference in how queer or POC children view themselves? And I will start by saying absolutely. Representation sure. matters. What How were there only like? Two queer kids on Glee? It's the Glee Club. It should have been 90. There should have been two straight people.
No, there was not two. There were many. There was Blaine. There was Kurt. There was Santana. There was
I clearly didn't Remy. Watch Glee.
I'm almost 25 and I have never done a lick of makeup on my own, but really want to pursue drag. Do you think there's a barrier to entry if you don't start at an early age?
I mean, you're 25. You have like your 80. You're 25.
Oh, yeah. You can start drag at any age. Yeah, and 25, that is not that old. I mean, a lot of people, especially nowadays, because drag is so much more accessible to a lot of people.
I don't think I'm old now.
You don't think you're old?
I'm like, I will hit you in front of all these people.
Best and worst celebrity encounters. Say their names. I think one of my best ones was, in person, Iggy Azalea.
Wait, one of the best or worst?
One of the best.
We don't want to hear about this. What's the worst?
The worst was Nick Lachey.
Ooh. Should I say this?
Yes.
I should?
Yes, you absolutely should.
I will say this. When Nico Tortorella did not win Celebrity Drag Race, they were not happy.
Bob, you messy, messy, because you know they're going to...
It's true!
Between you and Monet, who would win in a triathlon, spelling bee, and a hot dog eating contest? Well, Bob got the hot dog eating contest down, okay? Immediately. The spelling bee, we've done this on our Patreon, and I won.
I can't spell, but also, triathlon's not fair because I can't swim. It's swim, bike, run.
Well, you learn, bitch.
I can't swim. You're already ahead of me.
You can learn how to swim.
But you already know how to swim. So I learned.
I don't know how to ride a bike. So now we equal.
Yes, you can.
I don't know how to ride a bike.
Money, you rode that city bike all around town, and the whole seat disappeared. Where do you imagine and want drag to be in places that the art form is not right now? Okay, ooh. First of all, drag is in more places than you think it is. Mm-hmm. Y'all think drag is not around the world. Drag is worldwide. Drag is all over the world.
Oh, God, you're upset.
It's a phenomenon.
And I think it's only a matter of time until we are seeing queens fully on the red carpets of the Oscars.
They've been at the Oscars.
Oh, yeah, the Oscars. But I'm saying like a lot of queens. You know what I mean? As opposed to having the token one or two.
Oh, drag Shangela wasn't enough. Oh, my God.
What is your favorite aspect of drag? Oh, my God, the makeup. I don't know if that's corny to say, but...
You want a snap ass?
We were sitting down and doing... I feel like that is my moment where I really feel like I have like a good podcast playing, or I have some new music that I'm listening to, and I just get into the vibe, and I get into the zone, and I just really enjoy putting the makeup on. Like, today, when I started in there pressing this blue eyeshadow into my skin, I was like, girl, you...
This look- BOMO exclusively.
Yes.
What does drag mean to you? I want to make this... I don't want to overcomplicate it. I don't want to overcomplicate this. For me, drag is creating art and blurring the gender line. It's really that simple. It's really that simple.
To me, drag is liberty and freedom. I feel like I would have been caught in a lot of gender normativity if I never found drag. And drag was a vessel that got me to understanding my gender, my sexuality, and all those things about myself. So drag has really taught me those lessons about myself.
Drag is a teacher.
Drag is a teacher?
A teacher.
Thanks, everyone, for the great questions. Thanks to Beauty Fest for having us. And we can't wait for you all to see our new beauty line this summer.
And now we're excited to introduce you to Chanel Tyler for the Black Founders Roundtable.
Thank you so much, Bob and Monet. I just loved everything about this conversation. I cannot wait to try out your beauty line. We are going to transition into the next segment, which is the Black Founder Roundtable. All right. Well, hi, everyone, and good afternoon. So first, I just want everybody to hear from you, and I would love if you could kind of give us a little background about yourself as a founder as well as your brand.
I thought about the times in my life when I was most happiest, and one of those times was the times that I spent growing up with my mom. My mom was a chemist and a physician, and we used to make a lot of our own beauty products. at home using ingredients that we would source from the health food store. And I thought this was the perfect time for me to actually take that kind of childhood legacy and actually turn it into something bigger, which ultimately became the catalyst for me jumping ship at Goldman Sachs to start Briogeo.
So I met my co-founder in business school. One night we got into a conversation about life hacks, which inevitably led to a conversation about beauty hacks, because that's what you do with your girlfriends. And I said something like, I've been trying to find the perfect nude lipstick for like 3 years. We realized, you know, we were two women who were beauty enthusiasts. Mm-hmm. We had the disposable income to spend on it, but we felt left out of this global billion-dollar industry, right? And like, how could this be so? From that, Minted was born. And our kitchen sink story with Minted is that's kind of how we got our first products. When we talked to manufacturers, they had no idea what we were talking about or what we were trying to pursue. So we actually went on YouTube, learned how to make lipstick, went on Google, bought all the ingredients, and was cooking lipstick in our Harlem apartment.
I love that you kind of have that kitchen story. I feel like as like a Black woman and a woman of color, that is something that we really grew up like seeing, like our moms and our grandmoms. Like there's so much heritage and tradition and like ingredients.
Me starting the lip bar in my kitchen, it wasn't because I wanted to, it was because that was my only option. And so I'm really grateful that the lip bar has been able to double year over year since we started in our business. But at the end of the day, it would have been so much easier if I would have had the resources from day one to make the impact I wanted to see in my community.
Deanna, I would love for us to kind of hear from you now. I would love for you to bring the skincare perspective and kind of talk us through. You haven't launched yet, but we're almost there. So talk us through kind of like why you felt like this was important.
I wanted Black women specifically to want to see themselves. I realized along the years, wearing less makeup, you know, really focusing on skincare made me feel more confident. Being able to look into the mirror and not have to transform to walk outside the house to feel beautiful. I'm not having to kind of compromise on the packaging, the experience, the ingredients, all of that we kind of thought through. And hopefully we'll present this as like a love note to all the women that we thought about when we made it.
Something else that I've been thinking about, in the skincare space, there's not a ton of Black founders, or I would say women of color founders in that industry. Did it feel isolating when you were first preparing for launch, or when you your first year of business, did you feel like you had to make explanations or kind of get people to understand why you need to exist in your particular space? So I would just love to hear kind of what that process and that journey was for you in the beginning.
At the time, and it's crazy because this was only maybe 8 years ago, but as a female going to these different pitch sessions, I was one of the few women there. I was certainly only the person pitching beauty, and I just felt like investors didn't understand my product.
I agree with Nancy. It's definitely investors who didn't understand what we were doing in the beginning. We were talking about nude lipsticks for women of color, and all of them, mainly being white men, would say, but my wife, my girlfriend has no problem finding a lipstick, whether she goes to a retailer or a drugstore. And it's like, great, I'm glad she doesn't have an issue, but what about the rest of the world?
It's been interesting to hear investors think that, well, this person exists, why should you exist? And it's a damaging narrative because it does not work that way. So it took a lot of listening, a lot of convincing. I had to, you know, sometimes dumb it down a bit. I'm like, if you go into the bread aisle, how many versions of bread do you see there? Somebody wants gluten-free, somebody wants toast, somebody wants a baguette. And it's a matter of, again, providing those solutions where that customer is.
I love that. And let's keep it all the way real. Like women of color, Black women especially, they spend in beauty, and it has nothing to do with like what their actual like income levels are, right? Like we know that Black women especially spend enormous amounts of money on beauty products. And so when you're talking about like the need for you to exist, it's like you're existing because there's a market for it, and there's a consumer that's going to be willing to spend for products that work for her. And I think give us a really good transition. So we're going to move from kind of like the fruition and the past and focus a little bit more on the kind of like the last year up until now. So last year, the Black Lives Matter movement really sparked a pivotal moment in history, and it impacted many, many industries, forcing brands to get political for pretty basically kind of like the first time. How do you personally feel this movement impacted the beauty industry specifically?
I think the first thing that comes to mind is just accountability. I think especially for us that we love the industry so much, and a lot of us have been a part of it and willing to be, to show up and be a part of that fabric and kind of make this quilt for the customer. But I think at that time we had to sit back and reevaluate, like, if we keep going at this pace, we're doing everyone a disservice, because not only are, you know, are we diverse, but the generation to come after us is going to be the majority. So the idea of minority is not even a thing anymore. It's a lot of us coming together and realizing that multicultural is the new wave. So even if you're talking P&L and bottom line, like, that will actually benefit you. So how do we change this narrative now versus waiting until it's too late?
I think to the ones that have been authentic, I think there have been several retailers who took the 15% pledge, and we are in real time seeing that. We are seeing the shelves diversify in real time all across the store. And I think that's that kind of beacon of hope we should all hold on to, because again, I fundamentally believe more choice is always going to be better for the end consumer and for the industry, no matter what the founder looks like. But obviously, hooray if it's a Black founder, because we need those different voices. So I do think there's been some authentic change, but I also think indie brands have been the ones pushing the diversity, inclusion, authenticity more than anybody else. Because we have the agility and the authentic voice based on our founder stories to decide we want to participate or be as political or apolitical as we want to be.
For me and at the Lip Bar, we've always picked a side. You know, we've never been afraid to say this is who we are and this is who we're supporting and this is what we believe. And you're right. I think for the first time, lots of companies were faced with having to make a choice or, you know, potentially losing a customer. And I'm actually really happy that it all happened. I'm happy that it happened because for the first time ever, people understood that it's more than money.
We have this whole new kind of consumer consciousness where people aren't just looking to brands to be cruelty-free and to be, you know, to not be made with any toxic ingredients, you know, and to be organic. They're looking to see what is that brand's value? Where did they show up and how did they show up in the moments that were really important to me or to the people that I care about? And I've appreciated the fact that accountability exists a lot more now than it ever did. So we just kind of went through a really horrific wave of what's going on in the Asian American community with all like the violence and the attacks. And so, we're seeing lots of brands kind of start to step in and support the Asian community as well. I'd love to hear how you also look at that as a whole, and how you view allyship outside of maybe your core consumer base.
Just do what's on your heart. You know, do what's top of mind. It's completely up to you. It's in your wheelhouse. And just know that all help matters. Literally, like, there's nothing that's too small or nothing that's too large. You just have to show up.
I think for, you know, us, it's really about human rights. And that really expands everyone. It's something that I think, you know, all brands really need to think about, because I think, you know, during the onset of BLM, a lot of brands didn't have that diversity value instilled within their company. And for so many, there was this scramble to figure out, okay, well, what do we do and how do we respond? Do we respond to this? Because it wasn't actually rooted in their DNA. And I think that brands that are really thinking about this more intentionally need to think about this from a human rights perspective and really need to be inclusive more broadly.
What you saw in the responses to the Asian wave is that brands pay a lot of lip service, but they don't actually have the power to back it up. I think the thing that it feels difficult to be an ally when you don't have the right people in the room. But if you have the right people in the room and you've forever been an ally, then it's easy to quickly elevate a different voice or address something that's happening in real time.
So going from now, we're going to pivot a little bit into the future of the industry and kind of what's next. What does the ideal future of the beauty industry look like to you? What more do you want to see? What more do you need to see from the industry at large?
From the beauty industry, I think my big, hairy, scary goal is that one day we're in the position to not necessarily have to talk about Black beauty or brown beauty, that it's just the standard of beauty. It reminds me of, you know, the ethnic hair care aisle. It's like, at the end of the day, I don't think of my hair as ethnic. It's just my hair. I don't think about, you know, Black beauty. I just think about the fact that I want to wake up and look like my best self. And I want to have the offerings that will work for my skin tone. I don't necessarily want to have to be relegated into a particular part of the beauty aisle or a particular part of the beauty counter in order to be seen. I think that, you know, being a Black woman in beauty means that we are breaking the barriers that say Black beauty is beauty.
Just what I talked about earlier, just equity. I think we've identified the problem, but we're really looking for solutions that are not short-sighted and more long-term for the generations to come.
You know, if retailers, if investors were really open to creating this world of ultimate choice, then you need to have founders creating and generating all of that innovation. And I think if we just put customers first and allow for the funnel of innovation, we'd be surprised at how inclusive and equitable and diverse it all truly becomes. Mm-hmm. Because someone has to power that innovation for all different types of people. And there's no one person or one type of person that could do that. And so to me, it's the ultimate humanity meets business opportunity. If we really just change the way we thought about who is at the center of the customer experience.
Amanda, humanity you said that business opportunity.
So brilliantly. That. I know. Amanda, you said that so brilliantly. And that's absolutely correct. Because if you look at the heritage of beauty for so many years from the beginning, it was all about the beauty brand defining what beauty is, mm-hmm. the beauty brand telling the consumer what they need, what the options are. And it's starting to reverse, but it needs to reverse more.
Well, I cannot thank you all enough for joining us for YouTube's first Beauty Fest. I feel like I've learned so much from listening to you all. I'm incredibly inspired, and you all have dropped a load of gems this afternoon. So thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank
it
you.
Was literally so, so, so fast.
Boom. March hits and the pandemic starts.
There was so much uncertainty at that moment. I will never forget it.
Beauty Fest!
Beauty Fest!
Welcome to Beauty Fest.
Hi, Beauty Fest. It's Nikita Dragon.
Hey, Beauty Fest. I'm Remy Cruz.
It's Millie Bobby Brown here.
The most empowering.
Most empowering.
The most empowering thing about the beauty community is
there are no rules. You can define who you are, what you want to do, who you want to be. And I think that's dope and empowering and empowering.
What's so great about YouTube is that everyone's sort of inspired by everyone else's creativity. Anyone can be beautiful, anyone can be glamorous.
It's a fantastic channel just to break down the smoke and mirrors and make it real and show people real content that they can relate to.
For me, being trans, I was able to see the representation that I didn't really get to see traditionally, and I think it's so amazing with this platform to see so many different unique people and to understand their stories.
What I find most empowering about the beauty community would be the friendships that are created and the ability to express yourself.
There's a real kind of sense of encouragement for newness, for innovation.
I just love that it's so diverse. As a viewer, you're always going to be able to find someone that looks like you or that you resonate with. There is no other platform as diverse as YouTube.
It's so supportive of all different representations of beauty.
It's way more than just beauty. It is respect, it is support, and it is good vibes all around the world.
I always say makeup is like the key that unlocks your inner self-confidence to come out. You're not only giving confidence, people are feeling less alone wherever they are. They're feeling inspired, encouraged. It's something so much more life-changing that most people know this ever could be.
Everybody can come into the space, whether you're an amateur, whether you're a professional, and just be accepted for who you want to be, who you are. You know, it's an amazing
place to practice an art form. It's an amazing place to feel more confident in yourself.
It's all about helping us learn how to care for ourselves and build confidence through beauty. And what could possibly be more empowering than self-care and self-love?
What is a beauty fest without a segment on hair? If there's one person I know who knows everything on that topic, it's YouTuber, hairstylist, and friends of Kardashians around the world, Jen Atkin. I've got her on the phone here, and I've set her up with a pretty ridiculous assignment. I'm gonna let her describe it. Take it away, Jen.
Bye, Derek, thank you.
See ya.
Love you, Noah.
Love you, Jen.
Bye.
Of course.
Hi guys, I'm Jen Atkin, celebrity hairstylist, founder of Way Hair Care and MainAddicts.com. And the New York Times once called me the most influential hairstylist in the world.
What's up? I'm Noah Beck, content creator.
All right, Noah, I've got a challenge for you. Let's see if you can keep up with me in style and cut hair the same pace that I do.
Easy.
I went to 4 years of hair school.
Yeah, I mean, I've had a few haircuts in my life, so I think it can't be that hard, you know?
Are you nervous?
A little bit. I saw those scissors and I was like...
All I can say is, Noah, hair is so... It's such an emotional thing for women. So, like, there could be tears today. So don't...
All right, let's do it.
Got this?
Yeah, let's do it.
Bring in the twins.
Hey, guys.
Okay, so Noah, we've got twin sisters here. These two want to make sure that they look the same when they leave here today. No pressure. And I'm not gonna be looking at you. I'm just gonna tell you what to do.
Like I said, I've had a few haircuts. I think I know what I'm doing. Can't be that hard.
All right, so Noah, first thing is you wanna ask your client if she's going through something emotional, if she's had a breakup, if she just lost her job, before she commits to a haircut.
Yeah, how are you? What's your name, by the way?
Grazie.
Grazie, okay. You good? How's your week been?
I'm feeling great.
Hope it stays that way after this.
All right, after your consult, you're gonna wanna grab your comb and just comb through the hair. And okay, Noah, I have so many questions for you though. You need to teach me all the Gen Z ways.
The Gen Z ways?
First of all, why do you guys hate Harry Potter so much?
I don't know, Harry Potter was one of those things where I just never really got into. Big Game of Thrones guy.
Okay.
Do you like Game of Thrones?
No.
Oh.
For all you budding hairstylists out there, have your client uncross their legs before you start cutting because it throws the body weight off. What do you think, guys? All right, Noah, I got you your own fresh Supreme clipper set. Bring the comb at like the nape of her neck and comb the hair so that like the front of the comb is facing you. Are you right-handed?
I'm ambidextrous.
Oh, of course you are. That's so Noah Beck of you. All right, so you're gonna have your comb in your left hand and the clipper in your right hand. Let's say, let's take 4 inches off from the bottom. No, let's go 5.
Grazie, I'm so sorry.
Okay, now before you cut, okay. We need to tell the girls chin down all the way.
Chin down all the way,
okay.
Please.
Okay, clipper on. And you're just gonna go below the comb in a straight line. And you're just gonna kind of like have the blade graze the bottom of the comb.
Okay.
Noah. And this is where you reassure your client that it's so great that you go, oh my God, yes, queen.
Oh my God, yes, queen.
This
it looks
is life
so good.
Changing.
Hot girl summer, what you know about that?
We're not done yet. Oh my God, I'm so excited to see this.
Oh, I think I lost where I just cut. Oh, found
no,
it.
No, it's there. It's there.
Found it.
Yeah.
Oh, that shit looks good.
Are you done yet?
Do you like comb it and then lift it up or like?
Yeah, you'd lift the hair up, take the comb to the nape of her neck and comb
no,
it
No, I haven't
down.
Sectioned it yet.
Oh,
how do you section it so well?
Literally, like, just take less hair than what you just did. Put some of the hair back up. Also, will you teach me how to use sheesh? Like, when would I say that?
After Grazie sees her haircut from me?
Yeah.
She's gonna be like, sheesh. Yeah, do I make my way up?
Just make your, move your way up. Yes, you got it. Noah, I'm so proud.
This is
so easy. I feel like you got, what?
I'm kidding.
So easy. Daisy, how you doing?
You're so Gen Z, Jen.
So Gen Z, sheesh. What's my other thing I need to say? I'm busting to order a no cap, a skinny no cap from Starbucks.
Like, what are you doing now? Why do you have those scissors in your hand?
Well, I skipped ahead. I want her hair to look good.
I'm ready.
Are you ready?
Set.
Okay.
Yes.
Lift the hair. And then I'd say like the last 1.5 to 2 inches, take the thinning shears just underneath where the comb is.
Okay.
And you're just gonna give it like 2 quick little nibbles.
It looks really good.
I'm gonna be so mad actually if you're good at this.
Why would you be mad?
Because I just
goal?
Feel like maybe life's not fair. Haircuts, okay, haircuts
so
done,
good.
Haircuts done. Now we need to go to the styling part of our session. Take the water bottle in the side section only And you're just gonna give it a little bit of a spritz to make the hair damp. Okay, now you wanna turn the airflow and the heat up all the way, and you're gonna let the air wrap around the hair. All right, here is the most important part. This is the styling part. We're gonna use products now. You did okay. The haircut, you styled it with your air wrap, and now we need to get product for guys. And take just like a dime size amount of it and like rub it in your hands, and you're gonna kind of sandwich the hair flat in between your hands and just shake it to get the product in the ends. Oh my God, hot girl summer. Now you got a texturizing hairspray. You're just gonna kind of like lift the hair and shake it. Noah?
What?
I'm excited to see yours. All right, so we are finished. Let's see these sisters. All right, step one, take off your cape. Do it really dramatic-like. And throw it aside. Turn your client to the mirror for the big reveal. Ah! Wait, you actually did a really good job.
You think?
I'm so mad. I gave you the wrong attachment to make it look bad, and you did a really good job. No, it's good. I am real steady hand Noah Beck for the win. You did so good.
Thank you.
That's incredible. So that is the hair challenge. On to the next segment, because Noah's got to go to the gym and I have emails to answer.
All right, we out.
Bet that.
No cap.
Cheers. Cheers.
When I joined YouTube 3 years ago, what I loved about the beauty world on this platform was its sense of community. And when we knew we were going to launch a beauty festival, two people in the community who came to mind were Miranda Kerr and Hiram. An Australian supermodel and a Hawaii-based skincare guru may seem like an unlikely duo, but I was inspired by both of their journeys, which began in adversity and ended in personal triumphs. They've actually never had a proper sit-down chat until now. Please welcome Miranda and Hiram.
You know, briefly, I know that you both have had long, winding journeys to where we all exist now in the beauty community, but what was your first beauty memory? What was your first beauty product? What got you first involved in the beauty game?
I don't know what, I guess I started my first modeling kind of experience was when I was 13. A friend of mine entered me into a modeling competition and I won this competition, and the first photo shoot I remember going on, and I saw these racks of clothing, and I thought to myself, oh, wow, I get to choose what I'm going to wear. And they were like, honey, you got to wear what we tell you. I was like, really? That's so unfair. And so they put me in this brown top. And I thought to myself, oh, I'd never wear brown. But it actually didn't look as bad as what I thought it did at the time. I was like, oh, okay, I get it. It's the contrast, the brown with the blue eyes. I don't know. It was funny.
And Hiram, what were your sort of early beauty memories?
So funny enough, I really had no exposure to beauty or products growing up. I mean, growing up on a cattle ranch where, you know, life was very simple. There wasn't much discussion beyond like the basics of like what you needed to do to take care of yourself. And so, you know, growing up, if I had breakouts or I had pimples or anything like that, I was always suggested, oh, just go out in the sun will fix everything type of thing, which thankfully I know a little bit better now. But, you know, growing up was, I just had absolutely no exposure to it. And funny enough, my story of how I entered beauty is that I started rapidly aging, struggling with premature aging when I was in college. And I had wrinkles on my forehead, on my under eye area. And I never noticed them because it's just something I'd never noticed before until close friends came up to me and were saying, Hiram, you should start trying to take care of your skin. I'm telling you this as a friend, but you're starting to age really, really quickly. You should consider trying skincare. And it's something that I had never thought of before. After that, I went on to become a makeup artist. And then I started becoming really passionate about skincare. Before, honestly, I'd have to say like college was really my first exposure, which is pretty late, but I hope my story shows people that it's never too late to start taking care of your skin and taking care of yourself and finding the passion within beauty. You can start at any age, and the sooner the better.
What inspired you to dedicate yourself so much to certified organic skincare at a time when no one else was doing it, at a time where you probably had to put up some money? which I don't think anyone loves doing. What was inspiring you along the way?
I really wanted to create these powerful products that gave me results for my skin. I knew that, and I was, you know, educated enough to understand that what you put on your skin, it sinks in. And I wanted to make a conscious choice every day to put something that was feeding my skin and detoxing my skin and giving me the results I needed on a daily basis that was healthy for me. Being educated about what you're putting on your skin, what we put on our skin sinks in. And I've seen that firsthand, obviously, with my grandpa and that experience. And as he was trying to remove some weeds on the farm, didn't, you know, wash it off straight away, and it sunk in, and, you know, ultimately he, you know, passed away from that tumor that, you know, was growing because of where it spilled on his back. So I just think, if I can make a difference to people and give them healthier alternatives, you know, that hopefully will help them be healthier.
Well, Miranda, I also think you're sort of underselling. I mean, to my knowledge, you were one of the first, if not the first, certified organic skincare.
Yes. Well, yeah, we're still the only certified organic whole skincare range that Sephora carries. So it's something that requires a lot from like myself and my team, because there's a lot of auditing that happens by having a third party certify you. And it's something that I really stand by, that transparency and showing exactly. So it says on the back of the package, like, this product contains, you know, this amount of natural ingredients and this amount of, you know, organic ingredients, and it's by EcoCert Cosmos. And it just really gives that assurance to the customer that what we are saying is true. We're not just on a clean beauty rampage. You know, we've been certified organic from day one. So,
Hiram, I want to ask you, in our previous conversations, I've used a term that I'm told that you are not such a fan of, and that is clean beauty. Why do you why do you hate the term clean beauty, or what are your issues with it?
I will say I don't hate the term clean beauty. And actually, I'm grateful for the clean beauty movement, because I don't think without the clean beauty movement, I would have ever picked up a product, looked at the ingredient list, and really, you know, said to myself, okay, what ingredients do I want to look for? What ingredients don't I want to look for? So in some ways, I think if anything, I take a balanced view at clean beauty. I like to praise the good that has come from the clean beauty movement, but also recognize and hopefully tell people that just because a product is clean doesn't mean it's right for you. Like, the term clean, in my opinion, it doesn't mean that if a consumer is shopping for skincare, for example, and the only reference or guide that they're looking for is clean, that doesn't mean that all the ingredients are going to agree with your skin. That doesn't mean the product is going to be right for your skin type. It may have ingredients that could be sensitive to your skin specifically, just a little bit more guidance than that. And I think if anything, I'm also grateful for the clean beauty movement, because it's encouraged us to look at sustainability and how the cosmetics industry is contributing to a bunch of different sustainability problems. I will say, though, I have taken a position of criticism for the clean beauty movement, in the sense that skincare is complicated. You know, there's so many different viewpoints you can take, and it's a big gray area. And I think sometimes we tend to view clean beauty as a black and white type situation. If a product isn't clean, it's bad. If a product is clean, it's good. And I think there needs to be a little bit more nuance and a little bit more recognition that, you know, it depends, and it depends on the ingredients. And just because it's clean doesn't mean it's necessarily going to agree with your skin specifically. So I will say that I definitely don't want to say I hate clean beauty, because I actually, some of my favorite brands are some of the champions of the clean beauty movement. I take a little bit more of a controversial approach, I guess you could say. Miranda, I'm talking a lot. I would love to know your thoughts, because you are the founder of a clean beauty brand. And I would love to hear your approach, your philosophy, your opinion on all of that as well.
Yeah. So what's interesting is I personally don't like the word clean myself, because it's unregulated.
Yes.
Which therefore means that each company, each business can decide what they deem to be clean. And so for me, it's more about having healthy skincare. And that's why my skincare is certified organic. And we have been certified organic from day one.
So thank you so much for joining us today. We've got some more incredible programming, but thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you so much, Dara. Really, really appreciate it.
I love surprises.
I'm Katya Beecham.
I'm Beatrice Dixon.
My name is Desiree Verdejo.
My name is Chana Janelle Ewing.
I'm Greg Gonzalez.
Hi, I'm Katarina Schneider.
Here's my pro tip.
I want to talk about oil, the perfect last step. It's the way to seal everything that you've done in, seal in your natural good genes if you have those. So you put it at the end. Oil helps you balance everything. It helps dry skin by sealing everything in, and it helps oily skin by telling your body, hey, we don't need any more oils. Everybody can use it. There's so many different varietals, and one of my favorite ways to use it is as a highlighter. And that's it. We have so many oils and plenty you can learn at birchbox.com. I hope you will come and check us out.
My pro tip is vaginas are beautiful and our relationships to them may vary depending on where you are. The Honey Pot Company is a plant-based feminine care system for humans with vaginas. Beauty comes from inside. To humans with vaginas that don't think that their vagina is beautiful, I think that it's very important that they understand why they don't think that it's beautiful. I think that the first key to tapping into the beauty that is within your vagina and also accepting where you are with it is understanding that you really aren't in much control of how it looks. First of all, it looks how it looks. It is important to create a regimen and a beauty routine around how you care for your vagina so that it can kind of remain consistent. And also keeping a routine will kind of keep things together. So vagina routines are important.
My number one pro beauty tip is that cleansing is the most important step in any routine. The cleanser is the number one thing that can change your skin. Now at night, cleansing is an essential step because it's gonna remove all the daily dirt and debris that we get as we walk around on this planet called Earth. And it's also super important that we're removing our sun care, our makeup, and really getting our pores nice and clean before we go to sleep. This is our superfood cleanser, extremely gentle. You can use it 1 to 2 times a day, but it's also packed with antioxidants, phytonutrients, so superfoods from kale, spinach, alfalfa, all the green leafy vegetables that we love. My hope is for everyone to realize how powerful and life-changing it can be if we take some time to manifest how we want to show up in the world for our people and for our community.
Genie is a community-centered beauty marketplace that makes it easy to discover, shop, and share indie brands that mirror your beliefs. When you go to make your next beauty purchase, consider the 3 I's: identity, ingredients, and impact. You want to consider the backgrounds of the founders. An example of that would be Gold Label Cosmetics, which is a Black woman-owned brand based in New York. The second eye is ingredients, and you really want to give that a look. Like, is the product sustainably sourced? Is it paraben-free, for instance? If you see parabens or sulfates, you want to cross the street. An example of great ingredients is Cheekbone Beauty. It's sustainably sourced and also has really great clean ingredients. So the third eye is impact. What is the mission of a brand? What do they hope to achieve in the world? Prados Beauty, we really love because they give away 50% of their proceeds to Native communities in the Southwest. The brands that you choose should be a true reflection of the things that you care about. Shop with intention.
I'm coming to you guys from New York City, so you might hear a little bit of construction in the background. You'll definitely hear construction in the background. My beauty tip is to love your skin through every cycle. Hyper is a hyper-targeted, hyper-real skincare collection. We're all about celebrating real skin. Skin has pores, it has textures, we break out, we get dark marks. It happens to me, it happens to you, and that's all normal. One of the best ways to show your skin love is through a routine. Cleanser, serum, moisturizer, SPF is really all you need. Just as important as having a routine is being consistent with that routine. Just like working out, it doesn't work if you don't do it every day. My third step in loving your skin is to be patient with it. Our skin is doing exactly what it's supposed to do, And when we incorporate a new skincare product into our regimens, we need to be patient and give it some time to work.
My pro tip, the greatest thing you can do for your well-being inside and out is what you can commit to every single day. With 3 daughters under 5 and a fast-growing company, it's really important for me to find simple, consistent habits that I can incorporate into my daily routine. Let's take protein, for example. Whether you're an athlete or not, it's really important for building lean muscle mass. I like protein in my morning smoothie. Here's a recipe I like. 1 scoop of essential protein, 1/4 of a banana frozen, 1 spoonful of cacao nibs, some nut milk, and a handful of ice is my go-to. When it comes to my ritual multivitamin, I take mine every night before bed. Pick a time, stick to it. That's how you build a ritual.
Beauty fast.
Beauty fast!
Hi, Beauty Fest. I'm Paris Hilton.
Hello, Beauty Fest. I'm Shalom.
I'm Ismaya French.
My favorite YouTube comment.
When did the Moana crab get here? And it's on my all gold green look. I pinned it to the top of that video.
Hi, Jessica. I've had a hard day today, but I see you in this video, and it's like opening the window and letting in the fresh air and sun. Luckily, there are people like you who make life better.
That's so sweet.
Oh, here's a good one. Hey, my man, don't dress like women. I don't care what you think or feel. Just listen to me and try to save yourself from God's hell.
This is amazing. Can I just say, as a plus-size woman, working out with another plus-size woman is absolutely life-changing. I usually give up halfway through, honestly. There is no way I can meet their expectations or energy. No, I can't, because my boobs are about to be launched into space, and I'm trying to figure out how to remove the atomic wedgie from the front and the back without anyone noticing. I get so paranoid of the judgment when my body can't do what they want it to. At the end, I feel like nothing but shame and anxiety. But this, with you, I can do this. My girl Ashley, she's got me.
My favorite YouTube comment.
My favorite YouTube comment.
My favorite comment.
Yes, beautiful queen. So phenomenal. I just purchased 2 Illuminate Me Body Butter. So magnificent. So smooth. So luxe. Like excellent.
ASMR videos cause me anxiety, but this was so relaxing and funny. Freaking loved it.
My favorite YouTube comment I've ever read is,
wait, is this a dude?
Every time my glow babies come for the transphobes and fight them is a proud moment to me. The people that fight off the transphobes got my heart.
You are a bisexual's dream human. That's a nice one.
I don't know who else you inspire, but my life took a huge turn because you showed me that I can. Oh yeah, it's the tiny giggles in the random parts of the video for me. I'm flattered.
Any comment that has to do with my subscribers going out and buying products that I recommend and them falling in love with the products, it just makes me so happy to know that people love my recommendations and that they actually trust me enough to go out and spend money on things that I recommend.
I love how at the end, when the look is finished, you fall in love with yourself and can't stop looking at the mirror. Pure narcissistic delirium like the one all of us girls have when we transform.
Okay, the best comment I've ever received, probably one early on my first few months of YouTube that actually has a special place in my heart. A girl wrote me and she said, I wanted to commit suicide and I wanted to look beautiful when they found my body. Okay. And she said, I Googled how to look pretty, and for some reason one of your videos was at the top. And she said, I want you to know I've been watching you for 8 hours, and you've inspired me and made me feel loved, and I'm still here, and I'm encouraged to keep going. And I just never would have thought when I started YouTube that that would be a gift I would be able to give somebody. And I'm just so thankful for YouTube to be able to provide a place to do that.
Hi guys, I'm Manny MUA.
Hi guys, I'm Leah Yu.
Hi, I'm Patrick Starr.
I'm Desi Perkins.
This year has been tough on all of us.
This year has been tough for all of us.
Last year was so challenging.
But it's helped me uncover a new aspect of beauty. The beauty.
The beauty.
The beauty.
The beauty
of resilience.
Oh my gosh, at the beginning of the pandemic, I was here in Los Angeles, minding my own business, working on my brand, and it was literally so fast.
Boom, March hits, and the pandemic starts.
I was actually running 3 different businesses, and on top of that, I was actually 2 months pregnant.
It was really, really scary because I knew that COVID-19 already had hit majorly all across Asia, including South Korea, where our second office is. It was almost a ticking bomb for everywhere else in the world.
The fact that all this was changing so quickly and we had to stay home was such a huge, like, shock to, I think, everyone's system.
There was so much uncertainty at that moment. I will never forget it.
When COVID first started, a lot of people were scared that it is an Asian virus. There were definitely a small group of customers who didn't want to purchase our products just because it was manufactured from South Korea. So I think that was a little bit heartbreaking.
The main impacts on COVID on my business was timing. My business, One Size Beauty, was planned to launch, but we really had to be considerate to what was going on. And the last thing I wanted to do was make it about me and product, to have put so much work, but to then quickly pivot and brief a small team to move really, really fast and really redevelop a strategy was crazy.
We worked really hard to make sure everything got out the door and ran smooth, and it was great. But then once it left our hands and into the carriers, we had no control over anything. The packages were getting lost, they weren't getting delivered, they weren't being scanned until they were delivered, so customers had no idea what was going on with their packages.
There were a huge cost increase with the limitation of air travels. If you were to use an air freight forwarding service, the cost at one point was 9 times higher than the regular rate that we were paying.
Another aspect of it was, do people want to see makeup tutorials right now? I think mentally we were all in a different space. I couldn't give myself mentally to YouTube in the way that I wanted to because so many serious things were happening in the world that it just felt unimportant.
It definitely impacted a lot of people's mental health, physical health, emotional and spiritual health, and I was no exception as well.
It was so crazy that when I was uploading during the pandemic, a lot of people were watching my videos and saying, I'm so grateful for you to help us forget what's going on in reality. For 30 minutes, I can sit back and watch you and forget and know that when I'm watching you, I'm gonna have a good time and laugh and have fun. And so what I decided to do was kind of look to my audience, look to my people and ask, like, what would you guys like to see from me? I was able to receive mystery boxes from my followers that lived in different countries, in the Philippines, in Brazil, in just different areas around the world, and we would unbox together on my channel. Finding these different outlets was really, really, really fun, actually. It was really, really great to be able to experiment in this way that I wouldn't have had before.
A lot of us were reaching for an escape, and so skincare, beauty, treatment, mental health was very much a trend in terms of learning how to just live and how to be in this pandemic. People just wanted a sense of human connection in a socially distant world.
This is the very first time where everyone all across the world are faced with the same challenge of how do we adjust to this new normal? How do we shift our lifestyle to fit the new normal? We try to focus on what is controllable at the time, which was actually our sustainability initiative. It was a perfect time to reevaluate and assess where we could do better in our sustainability and set really ambitious goals for sustainability for the next few years in Crave Beauty.
I made the decision to move forward and launch my eyewear brand. I was like, you know what? I don't know when things are gonna get better, and I can't sit here and wait for that because I'm scared. So I'm just going to move forward because that's what my instinct told me to do. And it actually ended up being amazing. We sold out in under 30 minutes. It was one of the best days of my life. And even though we faced all of these obstacles, to have that moment where it just worked and came together was incredible.
People were taking a horrible situation and trying to find that little silver lining in it. And I think that when people started to feel at their worst because of what was going on, they wanted to look their best, to feel better. Any glimpse of happiness is happiness regardless. So I think that there's been so much growth in the beauty and skincare space that I think it'll only just continue to grow from here.
2020 taught me how to surrender. There are a lot of things that are out of your control, and if you do focus your energy and your mental health on the aspects that you can't control, it's going to drive you nuts. But instead, I focused on what I can control and what I can do to help me move forward, help business move forward, and help other people move forward in their day-to-day lives. I think that's what true resilience means.
There's so much that distracts us from living and what we should be doing. What this year has taught me is to find what's the most meaningful in life, whether that be family, friends. Owning your personality and loving yourself and being self-aware has been the most empowering thing to me. And I think that's the one thing that we all can tell ourselves, is that we are enough. And who we are and what we can offer this world.
Over time, I realized that there was a blessing in this situation, and that was that things became silent in my mind. I could focus on myself, on the life I was growing. It really gave me just this eye-opening experience of clarity.
I feel like there's gonna be so many different lasting effects of the pandemic when we're out in the real world and things are opening again and things like that. But I feel like the world came together in such different ways, you know, and they were so resistant and resilient to so many different things. And I think that things like that might not have happened without the pandemic. Yes, life's gonna open up again, but I think that connectedness that we feel with our audience, it's gonna stay. This year has been a lot of personal growth for myself as well as so many others. They really had to look inward and see who they are as human beings. And I think that this pandemic has helped me to realize I'm so much more than just a beauty blogger. I'm, you know, Manny Gutierrez. And I wanna say that the beauty community that I've seen in the last year and a half that has been resilient and amazing and, you know, so connected, that's the beauty community I wanna be part of. And that's the one I am a part of.
Earlier in the show, we surprised three YouTubers with a skincare routine from Pharrell himself. Well, ready to take it up a notch? This is YouTuber Melissa Alatorre. She thinks she's going to get a makeup tutorial at the Rare Beauty offices in Los Angeles from celebrity makeup artist Hung Vango.
So you're gonna tell me what to
do? Yeah, Hi Beauty Fest. Sorry, that one.
Hi Beauty Fest.
What Melissa doesn't know is that Selena is crashing her makeup tutorial and doing her face herself. Over to you guys.
I love surprises. Let's see how this goes.
So I'm gonna give you a little massage first. So just close your eyes.
Okay.
And I want you to really relax. And this is just a mattifying primer. And you have some moisture already. I just want you to really relax. Enjoy the process.
I mean, I think that looks good.
At first, I was like, I don't think she gets it.
I was like this. I was like, oh my God.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm shook. I was like, those are not his hands.
I
was
like, I like your end.
So the surprise is I'm not going to do your makeup. We will do in the future, but today is the honor. Is Selena going to do your makeup?
Okay,
my heart just went.
I can't do it as great as either one of you, so I apologize.
This is so fun.
So, did you prep her skin, Hung?
She prepped before she came, okay. So now I think we're just going to do a little primer.
Which primer are you using?
This is the mattifying primer. I loved it because, especially on the T-zone in the summer, I think it's great to use this a little bit first before the makeup, and then you go on the rest.
Oh my God, I'm so nervous.
I'm nervous.
You do great makeup. You can do this.
Here.
So is this, okay, skin matching, everything, you were able to find that perfectly?
We did the little bit, little tan, I think it's nice.
So I kind of apply, I'm gonna do just two here, do a couple. This is my problem area for me.
Oh yeah, same. The redness.
Yes, like nobody's business. Okay, you can use your hands, as I'm sure you know, but I'm gonna do a little like circular motion, getting the
Thank you, I'm trying.
Should I, do you want to help me with?
I think for summer you don't need too much. I think maybe a little more on the T-zone. I do just a little
See,
more.
See, that's my area.
You know?
You have such pretty hair.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm not really good at staying on the course.
How about we work together so it's easier?
Well, I need you on my life.
Oh, no, let me do it together.
Ah, you mean you want to do it. Hug and I are like brother
oh my
and sister.
I love this. Wait, I'm so glad I didn't eat the Cheetos that were in the green room.
Why? You should have brought them.
I would have had like the worst breath. I'd be like, wow, I was just breathing hot Cheeto breath on Selena's face. Great.
Hey, that's so on brand for me, so.
Wow, skin look amazing.
Let yeah, it
blend
does.
A little bit into the neck and that's it.
Okay. So now we're gonna do this concealer and your color is 260N.
Like, definitely one of the people that goes over the top with the concealer.
I mean, same.
But the finishing of the concealer and the foundation is more natural finish, so even you put a lot on, it still look like skin, which is great.
How is it, hon? Should I blend in and put a little bit more here? Okay. Put a little on your lid.
I usually just go back with the foundation brush and then to all the edges.
Okay.
See there?
This is so fun for me. I do this with my girlfriends and usually they're just really annoyed, so. Hong has taught me when it comes to blush, if you want to give yourself a little bit more of a, I guess it's more
lift
of a
it.
Lift, you'll start applying it a little
the
bit.
Higher cheekbone,
yeah.
You can do the...
Yes. So this is my liquid, as you know, and it is in your color. But I like to use the spoolie to put it in the middle of the eye and then
blend it in
out, where that's at, so.
The color is great on you.
Yeah, it looks perfect.
Her brow is great. I think
gorgeous.
You can just use the to gel it out.
Okay.
I think it's great. Yeah.
Sometimes that's all, you know, Hong will do with my lashes is just kind of use some sort of gel to place it. And then you can apply if you need to after. This just gives you the shape.
I just always like a fuller brow. Selena fan, most of them like skinny brow, but I like it's fully brow.
Whatever. I like both.
Do you have like a favorite makeup look that you guys have done together?
I have different favorites. She have different favorites of her for
I
sure.
I love the green shadow he did. Yeah. I love the dark maroon shadow that he did for the AMAs. He like, was
Wait, I think I might have recreated that on my channel.
For them. You didn't do that one, I did. Remember,
That's so awesome. Thank you. That means the world to me. This is the lip gloss, Newly Rose.
Yeah.
I love this color, and he taught me a trick today.
Okay.
To get that full look of the lip, you kind of shape it and add more to this area.
Yeah, I just on top the natural lip.
Could do it. This is the first day I've learned this.
Basically, instead go along the your natural lip shape, I use a little bit on top here, and just give you that illusion of fuller lips.
He taught me how to do this, and on the screen, it looked like I had
a little fuller. You see that?
Juicy,
a little bit.
Yeah, just
it looks so plump.
Juicy, puckered lips.
Mm-hmm. Yes. This looks really good on you. Your skin tone.
Thanks.
All right, now will you help me do a few touch-ups, please? I always am constantly learning, especially from Hong in particular. I'm very lucky because Hong, correct me if I'm wrong, when we started working together, you.
So again, I'm listening.
I was like, you weren't as big as you are now.
What do you mean? I'm always big.
I can't.
It must be such a cool feeling to use all of your own products.
That's like the strangest part, because I'm holding something that I created and that I was able to create with an amazing team. What's this?
Just hold, so you wrap it up. It's not a wrap-it, so they know what they continue. No, they continue what from what earlier.
Yeah,
just hold it.
No. So continue what earlier? Like you pretend now you.
Oh my God, you look so beautiful. No, you honestly are stunning when we even before this happened.
Thank you.
But you look gorgeous. This is such a nice look for every day, for going somewhere. It didn't take long at all.
No.
I just had the power duo do my makeup.
I just have the coolest girl sitting down. Okay. Let's show you a little what we did.
Oh, wow. That is seriously really effortless. Like the fact that you guys did that in like
few minutes.
few minutes. That's crazy. You guys, thank you so much. Like, oh, wow. Thank you for taking time out of your busy day. I can't even imagine. I'm like, you're probably so slammed.
This stuff is what I love. Now, what do I do? Because I don't do these videos. That was my look. Using Paul Rand
and
Beauty.
Scene.
But we hope you like the look. Come.
And don't forget to subscribe to my channel.
Of course. Don't forget to subscribe to mine also.
Yes. And thumbs up and subscribe.
Hit that notification bell too while you're at it.
What? What? There's so many things you have to do now.
Oh my goodness, you guys. Oh my God.
That's a wrap on YouTube's first ever inaugural beauty festival. Thank you so much for joining. On behalf of YouTube and Google and creators and models and hairstylists and makeup artists around the world, beauty is truly a one-size-fits-all industry, so I hope you found something to be inspired by today. Thank you for joining us, and next year, I hope we can do it in person.
Thank you everyone who tuned in to YouTube's very first Beauty Fest. One of the most liberating, creative things I've ever done is creating my YouTube channel. And I'm really excited that you all are here with us today.
Thank you so much for everyone that is watching Beauty Fest. And thank you especially for supporting the creative makeup community.
Thank you to all of you guys from Beauty Fest watching this. I appreciate you all.
Thank you. Thank you. Gracias to every single one of you.
Thank you to everyone on YouTube and just this platform in general for giving me the space to feel confident enough to share my trans identity. I came out on YouTube and this is how I got so many doors open for me. I think it's so insane that I found a safe space of loving and accepting people around the world that might not even come from my same background or journey, but for some reason I was able to turn to the online to kind of create this little kingdom for myself.
Thank you guys so much for watching Beauty Fest. Thank you to all the fans out there. I had so much fun talking all things beauty.
Thank you guys so much for all the love, all the support. I'm so happy to be here.
Thank you to everybody watching Beauty Fest. I can't wait to see everything that you create.
Thank you so much, Beauty Fest, for having me, and thank you all for watching. Remember to always be, okay, if y'all don't know what I'm gonna say, always be your own kind of beautiful.
I wanted to send a big thank you to the fans for watching and for everyone tuning into the Beauty Fest.
Love you guys.
Thank you, Beauty Fest.
Bye.